Welcome to this session. And today, so I want to go through disorders of sex development with you all. Next slide, please. Yeah, so disorders of sexual development are actually congenital conditions in which the development of the chromosomal sex, the gonadal sex, and or the anatomical sex is atypical. And broadly, you must be all aware now with the 2006 new classification, it is broadly categorized into three categories based on the karyotype. So you have 46XX DSD, 46XY DSD, and the chromosomal DSDs, where the karyotype is neither 46XX or XY, but something different, something atypical. Can I move the slides or should I? Yes. Right. So let's start with a small case scenario. So you are called to see a newborn baby in the labor room. The midwife wants to know from you whether it is a girl or a boy because the parents are asking and she's not sure. There should be an image coming up in here. Yes. So this is the baby, the newborn baby you are seeing. So can you please take a moment to think what would you do? What do you think? Is it a girl or a boy? And what would be the next step that you do? So this is the genitalia of the child. You are seeing it in the front view. Right. So can someone tell me what do you think? What would you do and what do you think? Is this a girl or a boy?
Hello?
Yes.
Yeah. We can do ultrasound scan abdomen to right. See whether there are gonads in the abdomen and to see whether there are in the canal or the scrotum.
Yes.
CBS blood sugar level and electrolyte level.
Clinically, on your examination, would you look for?
Clinically, whether there are palpable testicles.
That's right.
In the scrotum also.
Yes, very important to see whether you can palpate the gonads. Now, the problem is you are being called, say you are the registrar, you're being called to the postnatal ward delivery room and the midwife is there. She wants, now the parent, mother is asking, is it a girl or a boy? And the midwife wants to know what to tell. So what would you tell the midwife?
We need, madam, further investigation to say whether the boy or girl actually.
So you cannot. Yes. So that is exactly correct. You should never commit yourself and say this is a girl or a boy. It's very, very important because this initial encounter with a child with ambiguous genitalia is a very stressful situation for everyone. So the midwife is stressed, she's called you because the first thing that they ask in the labor room is it a girl or a boy? You know what happens, right? And then that's the first question that all the parents and everyone else in the family want to know. So it's very important to state that we cannot tell. No one can tell at this stage because this child has a large phallus. You can't obviously see the testes. You have to, of course, palpate and see. And quite rightly, you have to personally go talk to this mother and tell her there is a small problem. It's difficult to tell. Try to minimize stigma by telling it directly to the parent and, you know, supporting them at the time. Do not commit whether it's a girl or a boy, if you cannot. And then what would you do? Quite right. So actually you are dealing with a child with a disorder of sexual differentiation. So it can be either a virilized girl or a virilized boy. Next slide, please. Yeah, so that's all. And for that, the best thing you can do is see whether you can, in the labor room, see whether you can palpate the gonads. If you can feel two gonads, if you can palpate two normal appearing gonads, most likely it's an undervirilized male. But still, we cannot comment or commit to this. But at least you have a rough idea what you're dealing with. And so as you quite rightly said, please, next,
Yeah. Madam, right. you request a control and get it the control, that would be easy, madam.
Shall I tell you?
Yeah, there's an option, the request for control, you can get it directly.
Thank you, I got it. Right, great. So, first of all, see whether you can palpate the gonads. Most of the time, they will be testes if they are palpable, if they have descended to a palpable level. Then, of course, as you quite rightly said, you can do ultrasound and look at the internal genitalia, whether the uterus is there, whether the ovaries or any intra-abdominal testes. Now, the consultant radiologist would be able to distinguish whether it's an ovary or a testis. The scans are sensitive enough to tell us that. And of course, you need a karyotype, because that for basic classification is based on the karyotype. Oops, it's not giving me control.
Yeah, it's there, madam. DS is you.
Right. So pressing enter. Right, it went. Right, great. Okay. So now in the labor room, before you go on to do your investigations, you should take a detailed history. And in that, very important to look at consanguinity, whether there were sibling deaths in infancy, any family history of ambiguous genitalia, and the other presentations of DSD. So there may be siblings or uncles or, you know, other family members with ambiguous genitalia, pubertal delay or lack of puberty, infertility, right? So it's important to go through the family tree at this point, because that's the most easily accessible information you have till you can arrange the investigations. Also ask about maternal virilization during pregnancy and whether the mother was exposed to any potential teratogens. It's important to ask whether the mother received progesterone during the first trimester of pregnancy. Sometimes if you have a threatened miscarriage, they receive progesterone, which can also virilize the female fetus. Then very important to get an idea about the social history, especially whether there was a presumed gender of the baby. So whether if they have any ultrasound scans done antenatally and they were expecting either a girl or a boy, or whether they didn't know and they so everyone is in suspense. If there is a predetermined gender, then actually the social consequences can be a little bit worse if it is contrary to what the expected gender was. So, and then you also have to find out how involved the rest of the family is, because of the social stigma and all the social consequences of DSD, try to involve only the immediate family and try to tell the parents to kind of try to minimize damage by not committing to one gender or the other, because we cannot go back on this initial communications. Right. Then examination. So one of the most important things that we need to do is to exclude congenital adrenal hyperplasia, because this is out of all the conditions that can lead to DSDs, the most one of the common causes, and also the most dangerous condition is congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Most of the time it will be a virilized girl, but sometimes with 3 beta it can be a undervirilized boy as well. So of course at birth it may not be able to appreciate, but if it is an infant or a neonate who has gone home and come back for something, then very important to look at the weight gain, whether the child is dehydrated and hyperpigmented. These changes of course will take about 1 to 2 weeks to occur. Also, sometimes there are syndromes associated with DSD, so look for dysmorphism and any associated congenital anomalies. The most important part that I want to go through is the examination of the external genitalia. So if you look at this picture, first of all, inspect and see So you use, try to use gender neutral terminology. So you have the labioscrotal folds, and in this child, I hope you can appreciate that the labioscrotal folds are completely fused. There is no perineal opening. So this is a child with a complete fusion of the labioscrotal folds. It's not pigmented. There is no pigmentation. There is no scrotalization as such. So the pigmentation by fixed scrotum, that's not possible. But you can see this is a completely fused labioscrotal folds. Then you have to look for the site of the urethral opening. It's important to do this first. Otherwise, sometimes you forget, especially at your exams and all, right? So look at the urethral opening. It's difficult to appreciate in this picture, but it may be in the perineum in this child. And also see whether there is one or two perineal openings. So that is the vaginal opening and the urethral opening, or only the urethral opening. So there can be one or two perineal openings. Then look at the phallus. So the stretched phallic length by using a rigid structure like a craft stick or a disposable tongue depressor, you have to see, press against the pubic symphysis with the proximal end and check to the free distal end and measure the length with a tape. So clitoromegaly more than 10 millimeters or 1 centimeter is clitoromegaly, and anything above 2.5 is a normal male penis. So to say microphallus, if it's between 1 and 2.5, then you have ambiguity. More than 2.5, you can call it a penis, and less than 1, it's a clitoris, right? So you can have, if it's more than that, it's clitoromegaly. If it's less than 2.5, it's micropenis. You can use either term. So best thing is to use the term phallus. Then for the gonads. So gonads, again, it can be a testis or a over testis. So better to use the terminology gonads. See whether you can palpate. Be very careful. Look, make sure that you are not retracting. It's not retractile. Palpate from the deep inguinal ring downwards and see whether you can palpate gonads on both sides. Look at the position, whether they are symmetrical or asymmetrical, and also the consistency of the gonads that you can feel. Dysgenetic gonads feel hard and irregular. They are asymmetrical, right, in position and size. So it's important to appreciate all these things in the gonad. Right. So, sorry, I think we skipped a slide. Right. Assessment, examination. Right. So this one. So about 1 in 5,000 babies can have ambiguous genitalia. So you may be called upon to see one. And in addition to that, there are other manifestations of DSD. So it may not be exactly ambiguous. Sometimes you might think it's apparent male, but sometimes we get babies referred from the surgical wards when they have severe hypospadias, plus or minus undescended testes, if it's a perineal hypospadias, or there's a micropenis with a bifid scrotum or a shawl scrotum, with or without undescended testes. These people also, these babies can also have disorders of sexual differentiation. Then you can have apparent female genitalia, but with inguinal hernia, and when it's operated, a testis is found, or any perineal lumps, which can be the testis in a baby with CAIS, or clitoral fusion. And then, you, of course, you can be called in to see a baby who has a genetic syndrome with associated genital anomaly. So these are the other presentations in early childhood. And when you take later childhood, or other possible presentations, or sometimes a karyotype is done for some other reason and you find that it's incompatible with the gender of that person. They can present with delayed puberty or lack of secondary sexual characteristics. Females with primary amenorrhea could have DSD. And sometimes during puberty, these may be picked up because the children develop atypical secondary sexual characteristics. For example, a boy with mild PAIS might develop severe gynecomastia. Girls with biosynthetic testosterone, biosynthetic defects may then virilize with deepening of their Y's, clitoromegaly, hirsutism, right, and external virilization. And finally, some of them with mild, with external genitalia being mildly affected, can present with purely with infertility. So what are the investigations that we do? Going through the list, because this is a fairly comprehensive list. So the karyotype, as we mentioned, is very important for our initial classification. In addition to that, so very important to exclude CH. So if you can't palpate the gonads and the child, or the child you are suspecting CH, please do a 17 OHP level and check the electrolytes. And other rare forms of CH like 3 beta also very important not to pick up. So you can do a serum DHEAs to pick up 3 beta. And if you have some doubt, you can do a synactin test to improve the sensitivity if the first two are negative. Then if you are dealing with undervirilized male, you can do the 8-AM serum FSH, LH and testosterone. Important to catch them during the first 6 months of life during mini puberty, because after that, anyway, the FSH, LH and testosterone are very low. So you cannot distinguish whether it's low because of a disease condition or because of the normal childhood suppression. So first, do it during the first 6 months of life. If you want, you can go ahead with a HCG stimulation test. I put the protocol there. So you take the pre-stimulation testosterone and the post-stimulation testosterone and see whether it has increased by at least threefold. Also, you can check the 5-alpha reductase deficiency by doing the 5-dihydrotestosterone levels pre and post stimulation and checking the ratios. That can be done in India, not in the state sector, but you can send it if the IT is indicated. AMH levels are also useful, but not available in our country. Then the ultrasound scan, again, a basic essential test, best done by the most experienced consultant radiologist that you can refer to. Always ask for a consultant scan, because this is very small, small organs and could be missed by a trainee. So you have to request for whether the uterus is present or any Mullerian structures, the gonads, and at the same time look at the ask for the adrenal gland and the any renal abnormalities, because these are also associated with gonadal development and CH. Then, depending on the condition, you may go for MRI, genitograms, evaluation under anesthesia, laparoscopy, and if there are intra-abdominal gonads, sometimes we go for a gonadal biopsy. So now that's the first part of the presentation. So how these babies will present. Do you have, I think we'll take questions at the end because of time. So next, let's talk about the diagnosis or differential diagnosis of a person or child with DSD. Right, so this is the 2006 consensus guideline, and I'm sure you are all familiar with this. If not, please familiarize yourself with this classification. So that old terminology is no longer valid. Hermaphroditism is completely out. We classify DSD as sex chromosomal DSD, 46XY DSD and 46XX DSD. So basically go by the karyotype. You have a child, you are suspecting DSD, do a karyotype and then find out which category the child falls on to. So I mean, this is a comprehensive list, but let's go through these three categories, and I'll try to make it a little bit easier for you to remember this long list. Right. This classification I found slightly easier to understand. So it because it divides 46XY DSDs into disorders of testicular development and disorders of androgen synthesis and action, which is easy to remember. And the 46XX DSDs, so the second category is fetal androgen excess due to CH or non-CH, and then disorders of ovarian development. So it kind of goes by a pathophysiological mechanism, more or less interrelated, but there are a few differences. So you can use both, just have a look at both and see what you remember best. Right. So to understand this, let's go back and look at fetal gender development, because that's the easiest way to remember these without having to memorize everything. So this is a brief overview. As you remember, in the very early fetus, you get the bipotential external genitalia and the bipotential gonads. But sexual differentiation starts pretty early. In the first trimester itself, depending on the karyotype, the baby will start developing as either a girl or a boy. So let's first look at what happens in the boys. So we know that the genotype determines whether a fetus becomes a girl or a boy, depending on the sex chromosome obtained from the sperm during conception. If the sperm carries an X, it will be a girl. If the sperm carries a Y, it will be a boy. Right. So if the fetus has a 46XY genotype, then sex differentiation into a boy starts in the first trimester itself, starting from 6 weeks of gestation. And by about 13 weeks, most of it has happened. So you can see in this picture, by 12 weeks of age, it has the gonads, the external genitalia looks like a boy. Right. So the SRY gene, or the sex determining region of the Y gene, in the Y chromosome, stimulates the bipotent gonad to form into a testis. And the testis contains of Sertoli cells and Leydig cells. The Leydig cells produce testosterone. By the end of the first trimester itself, the testosterone level produced by this fetus reaches adult male level. So this fetus is producing a very high amount of testosterone in the first trimester of gestation itself. Now, the stimulus for these Leydig cells initially comes by the maternal HCG. You know, during pregnancy, first trimester, HCG levels are very high, and that will stimulate the fetal testes to produce Leydig cells to produce testosterone. It is only in the latter part of gestation that the fetal pituitary is made and starts producing FSH and LH. So in the third trimester, the pituitary LH only stimulates the fetal testes. By that time, you know that maternal HCG levels would have declined anyway. So it's fetal pituitary LH is only needed for the last few weeks of virilization. This is why if you have a boy with multiple pituitary hormone deficiency, you don't see them coming with ambiguous genitalia, because the maternal HCG would have substituted for the LH and they would have virilized during the first trimester itself. Only the last bit of virilization is lost, and that is why they only present with micropenis but not with ambiguous genitalia. Then the testosterone acts on the Wolfian ducts to form the internal male genitalia and virilizes the external genitalia. So testosterone is also converted to 5-dihydrotestosterone by 5-alpha reductase, and that also helps in the external virilization. And finally, the fetal testes, the Sertoli cells, secrete anti-Mullerian hormone, which causes regression of the Mullerian ducts. So at the end of the, at birth, the fetal testes has worked to its full potential, virilized the internal and external genitalia, and regressed all the female organs. So this is what happens. So if there is any defect in steps 1 to 3, you get an undervirilized, you can have an undervirilized male present with DSD. So step one, if there's a problem in the gonadal differentiation into a testis. Step 2, if there is a problem in the fetal testis producing testosterone, like a biosynthetic hormone deficiency. 3rd thing, if the testosterone cannot act on the Wolfian ducts and external genitalia because the testosterone receptor is mutated. So these 3 steps, if there is deficiency, this baby will be born with undervirilization, 46XY DSD. Right. So with that, I thought we'll go into a little bit more detail about this. So if you look at the first problem, abnormalities in gonadal differentiation into testes, there are quite a few genes now being diagnosed. So you are all familiar with SRY mutation, but also SOX9, SF1, WT1, ATRX, and GATA genes are all now recognized to lead to gonadal dysgenesis. So gonadal dysgenesis can be complete or partial. If you take complete gonadal dysgenesis, it's more commonly known as the Swyer syndrome. There is complete sex reversal. The baby looks like a girl, but the genotype is 46XY. 25% of these are due to SRY mutations, and we do not know the cause for the other cases. Because these babies don't form testes at all, they will have a uterus as well. They will be completely female appearing, but only their genotype will be 46XY. Then you have partial gonadal dysgenesis, where they will present with ambiguous genitalia. And the Mullerian ducts may remain because not only the Sertoli cells, but the Leydig cells, both cells are affected because the gonad doesn't form properly. Because of that, the testosterone production as well as the AMH production may be defective. So you will have ambiguity and Mullerian duct remnants. And out of these, there are syndromic causes. So I will, due to time, I will not go through this, but I think you will find these notes very helpful. So SOX9 is associated with acromegalic dysplasia, WT1 with any rash and Fraser syndrome, SF1 with adrenal insufficiency, and the ATRX gene with beta thalassemia and mental retardation. Right. So that is for the first step, gonadal differentiation. So these, you can have partial gonadal dysgenesis, babies coming with ambiguous genitalia. Second step is if you have a problem in the androgen biosynthetic defect. So these possibilities are LH activating mutation, 17 beta hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase deficiency, and 5 alpha reductase. These babies can virilize at puberty when their testosterone production goes up. So it's important to pick these up because it has implications for gender of rearing. And the third category is if the androgen receptor is mutated. So if you are on the first two steps, when you check the FSH-LH testosterone, the testosterone will be low. In the first step, because you have gonadal dysgenesis, the FSH-LH will be high, and the test very high because of gonadal dysgenesis, and the testosterone will be low. In androgen biosynthetic defects, the FSH-LH may be normal, but the testosterone will be low. And in the third step, if you have a defect in the androgen action, then the FSH-LH will be normal and the testosterone will be very high. And the FSH-LH also, because there is no feedback, it will be high, but the testosterone will be very high. So there is biochemical correlation with this. So you can have a certain amount of, can come to a diagnosis which type is more likely. So again, we have complete and partial. In complete, there's complete sex reversal, looks like a girl, but there is no Mullerian structures. That is the difference between Swyer syndrome and CIS. In Swyer syndrome, you have a uterus. In CIS, you don't. In PIS, again, you have ambiguity, but that the special thing is during puberty, these children have gynecomastia as well as partial virilization. So very difficult to decide which gender to bring them up. That's one of the most challenging decisions is in PIS. Right. So those are that is for XYDSD. Then if you look at XXDSD, now that's a totally different scenario. Remember, the default mode in the absence of a Y chromosome is that you become a girl. Now, it seems to be a very automatic, autonomous development. Remember, the female fetus is within a female, within the mother. So the mother has plenty of estrogens. And the fetal ovary does not have to produce estrogen. Therefore, any problem in the ovarian development and ovarian production, those things don't cause problems because those things don't occur in a female fetus. And the mother always has estrogen for her to bear a child. So therefore, you don't get the similar situation in a female fetus. Now, of course, we have identified certain genes are important in ovarian development, but those are finer points. So what happens is if you have XDSD, it's always due to some external source of androgens, not due to gonadal axis of the baby. So the baby is protected from androgens anyway. The placenta is part of the baby. Placental tissue is fetal tissue. And the placenta has aromatase. And if there is any androgens, the aromatase will convert this into estrogen, protecting the baby from virilization. But if there is excess androgen from whatever source, then the baby will virilize. So these sources are either the fetal adrenal gland or a maternal tumor. If a mother has a tumor in her adrenal gland or in her ovary, which produces testosterone androgens, or the baby has CAH producing excess androgens, then the baby will virilize. Other thing is if there is aromatase deficiency, so the placenta is part of the baby, if the baby has aromatase deficiency, then also the fetal androgens and the maternal androgens which are in the system will not be converted to estrogen, and the baby will, and baby and mother both will virilize if it's a maternal source of placental aromatase deficiency. If it's CAH, only the baby will virilize. So with these points, it's easy to remember. So if there's excess fetal androgen production, it's CAH. Remember, it's a potential life-threatening situation, and 90% of 46XY girls have CAH. So please consider that. The rare causes are placental aromatase deficiency, maternal virilizing adrenal ovarian tumors, and maternal exogenous androgen exposure. So look for maternal virilization in your history and examination. So we use the Prada scale to classify DSDs, girls, the degree of virilization. It can range from stage 1, which is just clitoromegaly, to stage 5, which looks like a male but with absent testes. Then the other category, sometimes the rare things, you can have both testes and ovaries, or you can have over testes. So those conditions are mixed gonadal dysgenesis, where you have no chromosomal DSDs. You can also have over testicular DSD. 90% of over testicular DSD are 46XX, right? So that is a special case. It's not due to excess androgens, but the testes themselves, you have ovaries or testes, and we still haven't really figured out what's happening there. But these are the conditions where you can have testes on one side and ovary on one side, or over testes, or a combination of these. Then the other special situations are you have what is called testicular DSD, that is XX, which are almost normal males. You have the Klinefelter and you have the Turner syndrome. So all these individuals will have problems with secondary sexual development during puberty and fertility. That's why Turner syndrome and Klinefelter have also been included in the DSD in the 2006 consensus. Right. So that's the second part for differential diagnosis. And so we are moving on to the third part of our discussion, which is the management of a child with DSD. So this is a picture just to tell you there is no doubt this is one of the most stressful situations for parents, because of it's actually a social emergency, because everyone asks whether it's a girl or a boy, and to say I don't know is going to cause stigma. So just to put in context what a social issue it is for the parents. So if you have a baby with ambiguous genitalia at birth, like the first picture, the scenario we discussed, The best thing is if we can arrive at a diagnosis. That helps hugely, because then at least we have some idea from the existing literature what is the known natural course of children with this condition and what is their prognosis in terms of their gender identity, their psychology, their pubertal development, and their fertility. But remember, exact diagnosis is not possible in all cases. Especially in 46XY DSD, even in the best research centers, it is not possible to diagnose all cases. Very, very important to exclude CAH, because that can lead to death. But if not, then the biggest problem is the social impact, and whether we are bring up this child as a girl or a boy. Now, certain diagnoses are classically, it's easy. For instance, if you have a child with 5-alpha reductase, if you can diagnose it, then the gender of rearing is male. That is the firm recommendation for that. if you have a girl with CEH, most of the time you bring up as a girl because the child has a uterus, fertility, spontaneous puberty, all those things. But in certain things like PAIS, we also cannot. It's a very difficult decision. In 46XYDSD, sometimes if you can go for a trial of testosterone to see whether the baby is androgen responsive. But sometimes you can even have some responsive in certain types of PAIS. So it's not a 100% accurate situation. So gender assignment and birth registration is the biggest issue facing us at the initial stage. So it's important not to delay too long because that has social consequences. Birth registration has to be done within the first 3 months of life. So we have some time. Even after 3 months, if the parents hang on to their initial registration papers, then we can delay it and do it the correct way, without rushing and registering the child as a gender, which we then decide to reverse. Because legally, we cannot do it. The child will go through life having both genders on the birth certificate and both names. The legal proceedings are such at the current state. Right. So how do we assign a gender? We need to look at what is the known thing about the gender ID? How do these children develop? That means how much of testosterone have these children been exposed to? Because the fetal brain also virilizes with exposure to androgen. So when we are born, that is why sometimes if you have kids or nieces and nephews, by two or one or two, they differentiate, they behave differently. Boys like more, trucks and toys. So their toy behavior, their role play, their likings, everything is to a certain extent determined during fetal life. So it's very hard to know what it is at birth. Then, of course, the genitalia, we may need to do reconstruction. Is it possible to reconstruct as a female, make a vagina? Is it possible to reconstruct a phallus to enable sexual intercourse? All these are considered. And what will happen during puberty? Will this child develop male characteristics or female characteristics or not develop anything? What are the fertility possibilities? And often, what is the social circumstances? If everyone was expecting a girl and everyone thinks it's a girl, we have a situation like that now. So parents, though everything suggests contrary, parents find it very hard to change now because of the social situation. So all these have to be considered. Disclosure and counseling. You need to have extensive open discussions with both parents, close engagement and openness. We have to explain the current limitations of knowledge and what we know is based on long-term outcome studies, which are also not that prevalent. We have limited studies and it is an individualized decision depending on the medical diagnosis if possible and the socio-cultural considerations. Luckily, a large proportion of cases, because of the degree of virilization and what we know about the diagnosis and because we can arrive at a certain diagnosis, it is easy to kind of, what we do is we will tell the parents both the pros and cons of both genders, but we may know that one gender may be more beneficial for the child. But in a small fraction, it's very, very difficult. So they require extensive multidisciplinary assessments to reach a gender assessment, gender assignment. So ideally, multidisciplinary care from the beginning and psychological counseling and support throughout for the parents and the child. Then surgery, various kinds of surgeries may be needed. This is medication. So at puberty, we may have to give hormonal replacement therapy with either testosterone or estrogen and progesterone if there's uterus. We have to remember that these children are at higher risk of gonadal tumors, especially in certain conditions. So they need surveillance plus or minus gonadectomy. And finally, we need to talk about this condition to the child and adolescent. So usually my practice is to start talking to them by about 10 years of age so that it doesn't come as a huge shock to them, or they feel that they have been kind of misled and lead to mistrust if we don't tell them at when they are big enough to understand. And we need to make sure that we transition them to adult services to help them with their gender issues, sexuality, and fertility issues. So, in conclusion, one more slide. Okay, sorry. Yeah. So I think what I've tried to tell you, and this is directly from this reference article, which I recommend for you to read. So perceptions and approach to diagnosis and care of individuals with DSTs is continuously changing, and there is at present inadequate data to address major concerns like the best gender assignment, how to predict gender identity, what is the best timing for surgery, and how do we preserve fertility in these individuals. The best thing is open and ongoing communication with patients and parents with full disclosure. Remember, they will have lifelong concerns. There is no overcoming it. And what we need to do is try to get the best possible outcomes to improve their quality of life. At present, it is impossible to predict gender development in an individual with certainty, but hope perhaps in the future with PET scanning, we may develop that. And so there is controversy on surgery as well, by when to do, what to do. So that's the current state of DSTs at present.